On Good Morning Britain tomorrow from 6, Susanna talks to family man David Beckham on what it's like to be an embarrassing dad. Designer David Emmanuel reveals the health scare that almost cost him his life to Lorraine at 8:30 tomorrow morning. How well does Towie turn Take Me Out the Gossips Mark Wright really know his fiancée Michelle Keegan? That's what this morning's Philip and Christine ask at 10:30. And back for lunchtime gossip with another top guest. It's ITV's Loose Women from 12:30. Now, the latest ITV news in the Tyne Tees region with Pam Royal and Ian Payne.
Good evening, welcome to ITV News for Tyne Tees. In tonight's headlines, no more student deaths in Durham's River. New safety plans are finalised for the city.
When you've got the environment of that drinking by such a dangerous river, you've got to look at how measures can complement each other, I think.
Also tonight, cash for crumbling classrooms. Find out which of our schools will be rebuilt.
Plans for Alan Shearer to return to St James's Park are afoot after plans for his statue have been revived.
When you think of Newcastle, definitely think of Alan Shearer, so I would say yes, definitely.
He is a minor legend, he's not a major legend.
And we hear from cricketing hero Steve Harmison after being named manager of Ashington Football Club. Good evening. First tonight, no more lives lost. That was the aim of a meeting to discuss a final plan to make Durham City safer after three students lost their lives in the River Weir in just over a year.
This evening, the council has chaired a meeting with the police, the students' union and representatives from the cathedral and the university. Our correspondent Francis Reid is at County Hall in Durham where the meeting has been held. Francis.
Yes, well, this evening plans have been finalised into something far more concrete. Last week, of course, there were meetings to discuss exactly what should be done. In a recent student poll, 85% of students said they wanted to see more being done to improve river safety. It looks like, as a result of tonight's meeting, that will now happen.
One of the most beautiful cities in the northeast, and a place where thousands of students move to study at one of the country's most prestigious universities. But three students have lost their lives here in just 14 months. Soap Peters, Luke Pierce and Ewan Coulthard died falling into the river after different nights out with friends. And just last month, another student had to be rescued from the river.
The vast majority of students drink responsibly, have a good night, and I think events like this are just an absolute tragedy. But when you've got the environment of that drinking by such a dangerous river, you've got to look at how measures can complement each other, I think.
Now, those measures have been introduced to make sure no more lives are lost. Among them, properly trained volunteers to do night patrols, training for bar and pub workers to spot people who might be vulnerable, and radio so bars and clubs can call the volunteers to take those people to a safe place.
This is a drinking environment, Durham. Universities are generally, and we need to be protected.
The river's so large, and unless they do some large-scale measure of kind of barriers along the side, I'm not too sure how big an impact it's going to have.
We hope they work and we're glad that things are being implemented, especially after what's happened recently.
It's something needed to be done and it's amazing it's taken this long, really. So, no, we were all really pleased that action's finally being taken.
It seems like it's taken a while, but we're glad things are happening now.
The Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents will do a full report in the coming weeks to see if any more barriers or improvements can be made around the riverbanks themselves. But this evening, there are moves to make sure more is done and that it's done quickly.
Well, joining me now is Terry Collins from Durham County Council. Terry, thank you for joining us. We've heard some of the measures there, but there are plenty more, aren't there?
There are. We've been working with the Students' Union to design an education scheme and the university as well. £50,000 from the authority to actually, you know, make some changes. They're designed by the students, delivered by the students. That would be really good. working with all the licensed premises in the city. We've got arrangements with taxi operators, we've got safe haven in place, and we've got volunteers, indeed 200 volunteers from the students union as well, working with us. And in addition to that, you know, we're going to trial breathalysers as well on a number of establishments in Durham, you know, with the means of actually identifying people who are potentially intoxicated before they actually go into a premise.
There's a sense of urgency to get things in place. Is this all being done fast enough?
Oh, there's absolute pace and determination by all the partners here to, you know, to really deliver these actions. I'm delighted with the progress that's been made in the, you know, in the last 2 weeks, and you know, this work will continue.
Okay. A lot of students have looked to the council. Do you think that what's being put in place is enough?
Well, we've seen some evidence already of these arrangements working. I mean, this is a long-term, you know, issue. This isn't going to be solved in a week or 2 weeks. But the actions that we're putting in the place will hopefully set the scene for the future where we hope to eradicate these problems. All the partners are doing everything they can to, say, make a difference.
There has been some scepticism from some students about how successful the plans would be. What would you say about that?
I would say come on board. You know, we need the students to, you know, to work with the council. We need them to look after themselves, need them to plan a way home on a night, you know, act responsibly. And with our work and with the partners, we'll make a difference.
Thank you very much. Well, the main thing is that these plans are implemented quickly. It looks like that will happen as a result of tonight's meeting.
Frances Reid in Durham, thank you very much. Now, thousands of pupils across the northeast were told today that their schools are going to be completely rebuilt, saving future students from classrooms and corridors falling into disrepair.
In total, 20 schools here have got the go-ahead, including one in Gateshead that's been campaigning for more than 10 years. But as our education correspondent Dan Ashby reports, there are still many schools who have missed out.
Cold classrooms, holes in the ceiling, and decaying old shacks of wood. For many children, this is what a 21st century school looks like. And in Gateshead, they're fed up with it.
Really cold, a lot of them have got like damping, and the facilities aren't really good at all. Like, a lot of the computers don't work. If it's absolutely freezing in winter, you've got to sit with your coat on for the full hour.
But Wickham School is one of 20 in the northeast to win funding to be completely rebuilt.
We've got structures that are actually falling apart and decaying in your hands.
They've been campaigning for this moment for more than 10 years.
We've been managing down our expectations because we'd had so many false dawns and disappointments in the past that we didn't dare to hope. But this is fantastic news and a real fillip for the community, the parents and the students and staff at the school.
You can see from this laboratory just how old-fashioned this building is, and they have to spend £70,000 a year on repairs. So this money will make a huge difference. But 1,300 schools applied for this funding, and there are many here in the northeast who've missed out. In the last 5 years, the coalition has rebuilt 50 schools in the northeast. If elected, it says it will release another £4 billion in the next parliament. But that remains a fraction of the £55 billion scheme that it axed when it came to power.
Well, any investment in our schools is absolutely wonderful, and we've needed it for a long, long time. What is sad about the government's programme is it's now 5 years behind where we had planned it to be. So, you know, we've got new schools being built, new schools being replaced, which is great. But of course, that's a very small proportion of the work that should have been done by now.
Hilltop School in Gateshead is one of those that received funding a few years ago. It went from an old building to a construction site to a new start. And the head teacher says it has raised aspirations. Tonight, 20 more schools are celebrating starting this very same journey. Dan Ashby, ITV News in Gateshead.
A teenage boy has been knocked down by a lorry on a rural road near Hartlepool. It happened on the A689 near the Greetham turnoff shortly after 3:30 this afternoon. The boy was trapped under the vehicle and dragged for a short distance before being rescued and airlifted to the James Cook Hospital in Middlesbrough. He's said to be in a serious but stable condition.
Police have released CCTV footage of a knife point robbery in a shop in Wall's End. A man wearing a mask and hoodie entered Simply Food and Drink on North Road and threatened the woman behind the counter. He then helped himself to cash and cigarettes. This incident happened on December the 21st last year. Police are urging anyone with information to contact them.
A 14-year-old girl has been missing from her home since Saturday. Police are asking for information about Camille Barnes from Bedlington area of Northumberland. Officers say they believe she may have travelled to Birmingham, where she has family and friends.
Later in tonight's programme, Simon will be here with the sports. Plus, a plan to create a lasting memorial to former Newcastle United skipper Alan Shearer has been revived, but how much will it cost and where will it go?
And our weather has started to settle down. No warnings in place, but a real divide between the east and the west. But how long will this setup last? I'll have your full forecast later in the programme.
Now, a woman who couldn't have children following cancer treatment will become a parent after her best friend offered to carry her child for her.
Victoria Eames underwent a life-saving operation to remove her womb late last year. It shattered her hopes to start a family.
But when Victoria's best friend Jenna College was told, she offered to be a surrogate parent for her. Our reporter Matt Price went to meet them.
It is the most special of friendships, to be brought even closer with the gift of a child. Victoria Eames's world fell apart in October after being diagnosed with cervical cancer. The 32-year-old was told her womb had to be removed to stop the disease spreading. It'd leave her unable to ever have children naturally.
Just a routine smear check, progressed to having different, I had a colposcopy, that came back obviously with cancer. I've got an amazing partner, and that was the next step. And the first thing I did was apologise to him when I found out I couldn't have children myself. It was awful.
Victoria was supported throughout the treatment by best friend Jenna, who lives in Sunderland. After realising how serious things were, she offered to help in the most special way.
As soon as I found out what kind of cancer it was, and you know, the repercussions of suffering from such a cancer. It came out, you know, well, I'll carry a child for you, you know, because at the end of the day, that's what I believe, I'm really deep and I believe that's what women are here to do, you know, reproduce. And to have something like that taken away from you is kind of, it's heartbreaking.
The pair met 9 years ago whilst working in the performing arts industry. Since then, their friendship has gone from strength to strength. It is, they say, an unbreakable bond.
You can't put into words how much it means. You really can't. The friendship we've got, you don't want to see the other person's head. You don't want to see, you know, that dream kind of ripped away. It's part of your fairy tales.
So. I just don't like seeing people unhappy. I like to see people happy.
The pair are due to start the treatment in 12 months' time. For Jenna, there is no rush. Devoting 9 months of her time, she says, will make such a massive difference to her best friend's life.
I've lost a lot as a woman, but I've gained something really special because I get to share it with her. So I'm not going to thank her because she knows how much I love her and how much it means to me. So you can't. This is something we've got for the rest of our lives now.
Matt Price, ITV News.
I'm going to cry.
Well, joining us now from our Westminster studio is Natalie Smith from Surrogacy UK. Natalie, thank you for joining us. You know firsthand the myriad of things you have to think about when embarking on a surrogacy agreement because you have twins born to a surrogate mother. So for anyone thinking of surrogacy, what are the first things you should consider?
Well, for anyone looking into surrogacy, I would say that you need to thoroughly research what the financial, emotional and legal aspects of surrogacy are. It's quite a complicated area, and the best way to do that is to look on the internet and to look at joining a reputable surrogacy organisation like Surrogacy UK.
Okay, now you talk about those three different aspects. Can you just take one at a time? The financial aspects. What are they? Do you mean expenses for the surrogate mother? You don't pay the surrogate mother, do you?
That's right. In the UK, we operate a system of altruistic surrogacy. So you cannot make a commercial gain from surrogacy. So the surrogate is paid what's called reasonable expenses. And these cover things like pregnancy vitamins, maternity clothes, reimbursing time off work, travel to appointments, all these kind of things, childcare if they've got a family.
I suppose there's a sliding scale of what things will cost depending on what kind of job you do as well. But so what's the ballpark figure that we're talking about there?
That's right. I mean, it depends very much on the circumstances of the surrogate. But at Surrogacy UK, we advise a range of between £7,000 and £15,000.
Right. Now, talk us through the legal implications as well.
Well, in the UK, a surrogacy arrangement cannot be legally enforced. So the whole system is very much built upon trust. So when the baby is born, the parental responsibility will lie with the surrogate mother. And you then apply for a parental order, which has to be done within the first 6 months. And that reassigns the parental responsibility to the intended parents. So right. You really need to make sure you understand that you're eligible for a parental order and what the process is to apply for one.
And the emotional thing, you're talking about trust there, absolute implicit trust between the intended parent and the surrogate mother.
Absolutely. It is the most important part of having a positive surrogacy relationship. At the end of the day, the surrogate mother could decide to keep the baby, or the intended parents could walk away and leave the surrogate with a baby that isn't hers and that she doesn't want. So trust and friendship is all the most important things that it's founded on.
Thank you very much, Natalie. That's very good advice. Thank you. That was Natalie Smith from Surrogacy UK. And if you'd like to look into that further, you'll find links to that information and more on our website, itv.com/timetease.
Simon is here for tonight's sports in a moment. First, a quick look ahead to what's coming up when the ITV News continues at 6:30.
A teenager goes on trial accused of planning to behead a British soldier. It's alleged 19-year-old Brustom Ziamani idolised the killers of Lee Rigby and wanted to die a martyr. Labour pledged to double paid paternity leave to 4 weeks. Some firms are calling it a tax on business. And oh, won't you stay with me? How Sam Smith turned heartbreak into joy with multiple success at the Grammys. We'll do journalists here to me for that and more at 6:30.
ITV Time Tease Sports Report, sponsored by WeWantAnyCar.com, the Cash for Cars website.
And we start tonight with a very unusual sports story. Former Test match cricketer Steve Harmison is taking over as manager of Ashington Football Club. This is a real rare move, Simon.
Yeah, ashes to Ashington. I don't think anyone saw this coming, did they? Steve is swapping sports to take charge of his hometown team. The 36-year-old is known for his fast bowling exploits on the cricket pitch, but he's deadly serious about his new job. And this afternoon, Helen Ford went to meet him at Ashington's Woodhorn Lane ground.
Well, many congratulations, Steve, on your new appointment. I suppose the big question is, what makes an international cricketer a good football manager?
Time will tell whether it's a good football manager or not. It's something that has been, you know, in my genes for many years, and anybody that knows me will say this is not much of a surprise. It's got nothing to do with PR or anything like that. It is real, and I'm looking forward to working at what is my hometown club.
You are very much an Ashington lad. You have links with this club, as you say, other members of your family too. How much of this role will be about putting something back into the community?
Well, you look at the development that's going on in the wider community. This place is getting transformed. The £21 million spent on a new leisure centre. There's a new stand going up here, and hopefully, I shouldn't have been in a good place. Unfortunate the position they're in, because Ashington have done very well for the last 5 or 6 years. The previous manager did a great job here, and hopefully we can put a bit more confidence and give them some more for the support they get here is great, and give them something to shout about.
You mentioned your current position. You're 16th in Northern League Division 1. Not a fantastic position to be in at the moment. So what are your initial goals?
Well, the initial goal is to keep them in the league. Initial goal is to try and get 11 players fit for tomorrow night against Bishop Auckland. Yeah, Helen, if you brought your boots, you might have had a go, but we're a bit threadbare at the minute, but hopefully the people of Ashington will come out and support the team, because I think the team need that, and hopefully from my point of view, that's all I'll be trying to say to them, is enjoying playing for Ashington in front of a decent sized crowd tomorrow night and beyond.
As you say, first game at home here against Bishop Auckland tomorrow. Very best of luck.
Thank you.
If only Helen had brought her boots. Well, Steve Harmison's got football friends in high places. Newcastle United head coach John Carver knows Steve, and he's happy to get the kettle on if Mr. Harmison wants to pop round and talk tactics.
Homie, I can't believe he's gone into management. He must be crazy. I thought he was going to stick to cricket, but it's great. He's a legend. He's a North East legend, isn't he? And especially from the town of Ashington, where he's born and bred. His family have always been connected with non-league football. He might come in and have a cup of tea and share a cup of tea with me and go through some tactics, and he's more than welcome if he wants to do that. But it's great for him. It's great. He's a big personality, and he is a football person as well, so I think he'll do a decent job.
Harmy's also a massive Newcastle fan, so watch out, John. What about this weekend? John Carver's team, how good a job did he do? He thinks Harmy will do a good job in management.
Yeah, he wasn't so sure about his own team. He was a little bit annoyed at the end, actually. He wasn't actually complaining about the result as such, because he thought a draw was probably about right against Stoke City. But having taken the lead, he was a bit angry that they didn't see the job through. The Magpies messed about a bit at both ends of the pitch, and Peter Crouch, who always seems to score against Newcastle, scored against Newcastle. It wasn't a classic, bit of a mid-table feel about it. I suppose the battle for 10th place isn't really going to stir the emotions that much.
At Sunderland, somebody there is doing a great job, Jermaine Defoe, new signing and doing exactly what he was brought in to do.
It's dead simple, isn't it? Yeah, Sunderland's needed goals, Jermaine Defoe scores goals. That's why they got him, that's what he's doing. He's already scored more Premier League goals for Sunderland than his predecessor Jozy Altidore did, mind you, that's not difficult. It was a really good goal at Swansea City as well. It wasn't enough for the win because Ki Sung Jung, who was on loan with the Black Cats, of course, last season, levelled it up with a diving header. Bad marking there. But it's all about Jermaine Defoe scoring goals at the moment. And you know what? Gus Poyet, well, he kind of thinks we better get used to it.
I can imagine when I was, or when I watch other teams and you see the results and, you know, Diego Costa score, you know, what a surprise. You know he wouldn't score. And I think that, and I'm sure from now on, when Sunderland score and Jermaine is the scorer, people all over the country will say, oh, it's not a surprise. You know, it's Jermaine Defoe.
Some very sad news for Sunderland fans and indeed Hartlepool fans today. Nick Sharkey has passed away at the age of 71. He was a popular figure on Wearside who made his Sunderland debut aged 16 and was part of the much-loved 1964 promotion side. Nick later played for Hartlepool. Our thoughts are with his family and friends. Now, at the bottom of the Football League, North East football has a distinct sinking feeling, but at the top end, Middlesbrough are ready to pounce on the Championship's top two. Phil Roscoe reports.
Middlesbrough's pursuit of the Championship's top two continued on Saturday. Patrick Bamford got them off to the perfect start against Charlton. But the away side equalised towards the end of the first half. And what a goal it was. Johan Berg Gudmundsson's thunderbolt made it 1-1. Then after the restart, Borough upped the ante. Lee Tomlin's shot was blocked, but his pass was perfect for Jelle Vossen to restore the advantage. And then Tomlin showed why he was voted the Championship's Player of the Month for January. His sublime volley direct from a corner sealed the points for Middlesbrough. Down in League Two, Matt Tubbs got the only goal of the game as Hartlepool lost away to fellow relegation candidates Portsmouth. But thankfully for Pools, the three teams directly above them in the table also lost. And that includes York City. They were beaten 2-0 at home by Dagen Red after two goals from Jamie Cureton. Those results mean Hartlepool are still 9 points from safety, but York drop into the bottom two after that defeat. Phil Roscoe, ITV News.
It was another stellar weekend for the Newcastle Eagles. On Friday night, they destroyed Leicester, one of their main rivals for the British Basketball League title. And yesterday, they won in Glasgow to reach the BBL Trophy semi-finals. And well done to the Falcons. Their Anglo-Welsh Cup game at London Irish was a dead rubber because neither team could make progress, but Newcastle were terrific and won by 31 points to 13.
And we've got to talk about the rugby before you go briefly. Kieran Brooks of the Falcons, what a great weekend.
Yeah, good weekend. He came on for England in the second half of their brilliant performance in Wales. They were absolutely magnificent. Well done, Kieran.
Fantastic way to start the weekend. That was Simon. Thank you very much.
And keeping with the sporting theme, it's been reported that Newcastle United's former owner, Freddie Shepherd, is talking to Alan Shearer about the resurrection of a plan to create a full-size statue of the man himself. It was first commissioned by Mr. Shepherd 8 years ago, but it was never finished.
Well, today, fans groups have backed the idea. There's a shock. Our reporter, Julia Bartham, went to meet the man who was asked to create the statue all those years ago.
Sculpting is Tom Maley's passion and his business. He's moved on to many other projects, but the scale model of Alan Shearer still takes pride of place in his workshop, shoulder to shoulder with those other great Newcastle legends, Sir Bobby Robson and Jackie Milburn.
When the project first started, I was able to get Alan in the studio and take his photograph him and measure. All the artistic work is done, all the design and all the technical work has been done. It could be done and could be up in a matter of a few short months.
The idea is Jackie Milburn passing the ball to Alan Shearer, both standing 9 feet tall outside St James's Park. But when Newcastle United was sold and as the team battled relegation, the project was put on hold. With Alan Shearer's record as Newcastle and the Premier League's highest scorer still standing, Fans say the time is right to finish the statue.
The Alan Shearer statue is particularly important because he is the club's all-time goal scorer. He's somebody who is a fantastic ambassador for the region, you know, with his Alan Shearer Foundation and the various charity work he's taken up over the years for, you know, the likes of the NSPCC and the Chough Charity, etc. I think he's done so much work that I think it's only befitting that the club, you know, put a statue outside there.
It would take £65,000 to finish each statue. Freddie Shepherd and Alan Shearer are reported to be talking about possible options as they attend a golf tournament in Dubai. Julia Barthram, ITV News, Newcastle.
So what do the fans think about this on the streets of Newcastle today? Well, it was a mixed reaction.
He's a hero. Yeah, definitely. I think he's... When you think of Newcastle, you definitely think of Alan Shearer, so I would say yes, definitely.
He's a good patron for all the charity work he does and things like that. I think he deserves to have some sort of statue for him.
Absolutely, without a doubt. He's such an example, isn't he?
There are two statues outside of St. James's Park, Jackie Milburn and Sir Bobby Robson, and while he is a minor legend, he's not a major legend in their category.
Well, this is the talking point tonight on social media as well, on Twitter and Facebook. You've been telling us whether you think it should be finished, this statue.
Yeah, Claire Maguire says 100% yes, he's a legend and a local hero.
TM Robinson doesn't think it should be. He says Shearer was good, but not that good.
Well, Lee Ralph is in total agreement to complete it and thinks it should be 50 feet tall.
Neorg thinks either Kevin Keegan or Sir John Hall would be more worthy of a statue.
But Chris Embleton says yes, because Shearer was the greatest scorer of our generation and loyal. Why wait till someone dies before we honour them in this way?
That's a decent point. And finally, Andy Wilton thinks a 9-foot statue of Alan Shearer would have had more positive impact on the pitch than half of the current first team. Andy, can possibly comment.
You can vote whether Shearer should be immortalised in bronze online at itb.com/tinytees. So far, 85% of people have backed the plans. I wonder if 85% of people saw the sunset on Saturday, Rob.
Because that was a definite winner. Universally,
brilliant.
That was a fantastic thing. Yeah, the sunset on Saturday night, my Twitter went mad. Emails, literally hundreds of emails over the weekend of shots like this. I mean, can you believe it? Just stunning, stunning colours all over the place and right across the region too. I've picked three or four today because I'm still going through them from the weekend. I mean, you can just see the colours there, the reds, the purples, the oranges.
Play them all week.
The yellows, yeah.
Well, was this being seen right across the country then?
It looks like it was actually the north of the UK, basically. We were in a prime position to get it, and it was caused by ice crystals up in the cloud. So it was actually very rare, leading to these stunning scenes.
Terrific.
What do they say? Red sky at night, shepherd's delight. And it's been pretty settled ever since. It was that impressive. It's had a knock-on effect through the week. Today was lovely and calm. This is a satellite from earlier. Cloud in the west, but for us, pretty much unbroken blue skies. Now, it's clear and calm. This comes at a bit of a price, and it's old Topcliffe in North Yorkshire that saw this. Overnight last night, the coldest place in the country, down to -5.4, so very chilly indeed. But strangely, on the flip side, it was also the warmest place in the country today, getting up to 12 degrees, so back into double figures. 17 degrees difference in the temperatures there, although it's already dropped down to 6 degrees now. So
already?
Again, it's going to tumble down. But the weather's fine. It's settled. Winter sunshine. Can't complain. Here's the forecast.
It's always sunny somewhere. Thompson sponsors ITV Tinytees weather.
So it has been a lovely example of a winter day for the Tinytees region. Plenty of blue skies, lots of sunshine around, temperatures well above average for the time of year. This setup will continue, actually, for the next few days. Variable amounts of cloud around, particularly in the west, brighter in the east, and some fog patches developing overnight in these very light breezes. And the reason for all this is high pressure, keeping things nice and calm. It's been settling in over the UK and will stay with us for a good few days yet before gradually easing its way out towards the east. And behind that, things turning a bit more unsettled for a while. Some outbreaks of rain could be on the way for Friday, but then behind that, it's looking increasingly likely the high pressure will build in once again and keep things nice and calm into next week. So this is the setup for this evening, overnight and the next few days. Out towards the east, clearer skies, chilly certainly overnight, with the cloudy and fog patches trying to push in from the west. So overnight tonight, underneath those clearer skies, temperatures down to 2 or 3 degrees in towns and cities, so even lower in more rural spots could see a touch of frost. Cloudier inland, temperatures not as low here. We also have these patches of mist and fog starting to form, and they will still be lingering as you wake up tomorrow morning. But it's a decent start to the day. Plenty of breaks in the cloud, allowing the sunshine through. And very much like today, out towards the east coast, lots of sunshine through the afternoon. Cloudier inland with highs of around 7 or 8 degrees. Have a good evening.